Welcome to Caltrans LSIT LS exam preparation course. One aid in your preparation for California licensure examinations. A word of caution, don't use this course as your only preparation. Devise and follow a regular schedule of study which begins months before the test. Work many problems in each area, not just those in this course's workbook, but problems from other sources as well. This course is funded by Caltrans, but you and I owe a profound thanks to others, the course's instructors, from the academic community, the private sector, other public agencies, and from Caltrans as well. We wish you well in your study toward becoming a member of California's professional land surveying community.
Hello, I'm Russ Forsberg. I'm a licensed land surveyor in the state of California. My number is LS4213. I am a semi-retired Caltrans land surveyor currently involved with the Caltrans training class known as the Trilogy. My land surveying experience with Caltrans was about equally divided between surveys and right-of-way engineering. While I was in right-of-way engineering, I had charge of a squad that did nothing but write legal descriptions. That brought me into constant touch with right-of-way agents, attorneys, title company personnel, as well as surveyors. I have also had some experience in the private sector, where I did a few parcel maps and some other small surveys. I'm going to talk to you about legal descriptions. A legal description is a word picture that actually and accurately describes a parcel of land. The late Gurdon Wattles, in his excellent book, Writing Legal Descriptions, says the following about them. A description of the outline of a certain area is the proper grouping of words that delineates one specific piece of land and which cannot apply to any other piece of land, although the definition is correctly stated as land description, it is generally called legal because it must stand up under the law and litigation. A typical description usually includes preamble or caption, the body, and qualifying or augmenting clauses. The first two are sometimes combined in one short paragraph. There are frequently no qualifying or augmenting clauses needed. A good legal description has the following characteristics. It's capable of only one interpretation. It's short but clear. It's surveyable. It's legal. And it's insurable. Let's take a look at these points one at a time. Capable of only one interpretation. All of us use words in ordinary conversation that have vastly different meanings to different people. Words like mostly, somewhat, generally, and so forth are vague. For instance, what does generally mean? Does it mean 50% of the time, 75% of the time, or something else? Words like this have their places in general conversation, but do not fit in legal descriptions. Terms like more or less are sometimes found in legal descriptions, but they are always accompanied by another, more precise statement that is intended to control. Knowledgeable people in the fields of land surveying and title work must agree on the interpretation. If there is disagreement among professionals as to the meaning of words or techniques used, the writer must look for a different way of saying what he or she wanted to say. You may have your own pet way of saying something, and it may even stand up in court. But if other professionals in the field are divided in their interpretations of what you said, you really ought to change your style and technique in a way that will result in descriptions that are capable of only one interpretation. Short. The description should be short, consistent with clarity. Clarity must not be sacrificed for brevity, however. It must clearly describe the parcel, but on the other hand, unnecessary language must be avoided. After all, the more wordy a document is, the more chances there are for errors. Surveyable. It must be surveyable. The surveyor begins with monuments on the ground. If there are none at all on the perimeter of the subject parcel, the surveyor must find monuments somewhere and work his or her way into the parcel. That means that proper writing techniques must be used to make sure that the description will be oriented in the correct manner so that the parcel can be marked out on the ground where the writer intended. That can be done if the writer is familiar with the proven techniques that are available to us. It is particularly important that descriptions that include free line calls or new property lines be written in such a way that the new lines can be surveyed and monumented with confidence, with no chance of someone later proving that the lines should be placed in another position. There are a number of techniques available that can assist in reaching this goal. We'll examine some shortly. Legal. It must be able to stand a test in court if necessary. In other words, the writer must use words and techniques in the way in which a court of law will understand them. There is frequently a great difference between the legal definition of a word and the general public's understanding of what it means. And the writer must be aware of the differences. Insurable. Title companies issue insurance on descriptions, stating, among other things, that it does not conflict with descriptions of adjoining parcels. If title company personnel think that a description is poorly written and may not be able to stand a legal test in court, they are not likely to insure it. That insurability standard is a higher standard than just being legal. The title person is not likely to insure the description unless it is clearly legal and not borderline. Writers who are really successful invariably have certain basic qualifications. They usually, 1, understand boundary determination principles, 2, understand the legal meaning of words used, and 3, understand accepted writing techniques. Let's take a look at them one at a time. 1, understand boundary determination principles. It is impossible to be a good description writer without a good understanding of boundary determination principles. It is not uncommon to find two or more monuments, each purporting to mark the location of one corner. The writer must be in the habit of checking the pedigree of each monument found. If the pedigree is good, it can be traced back to the original monument. If some kind of monument is found somewhere near where the corner is thought to be, but the monument cannot be traced back to the original, the writer really doesn't know where the corner is. The writer must recognize and accept that fact and use a technique that will allow for it. 2, understand the legal meaning of words used. Any description may end up in court at some time. If and when it does, the court will interpret it based on the legally accepted definitions of words used, whether the writer understood them that way or not. Get in the habit of looking up words in a dictionary. And please don't use a dime store dictionary. Use a good legal dictionary like Black's Law Dictionary or the Title Handbook. You'll find reference to them in your workbook. 3, understand accepted writing techniques. In communicating with any group, the writer or speaker must understand the language and thinking of his or her listeners. One goal of the person writing legal descriptions is to convince his or her fellow professionals. Those professionals have developed a language and certain writing techniques all their own. It is vital that we understand them and learn to use them. Descriptions we write will be more readily accepted by them if we use procedures and techniques they are familiar with. Now, the writer's frame of mind. Write as though three people representing three different professions were looking over your shoulder. Those three are, one, the surveyor, two, the title person, and three, the judge. Each has a unique, special interest in the description. Now let's take a look at each of these points of view. One, the surveyor is interested in a place to start in the field, a way to orient the bearings in the description, and enough information to allow him or her to calculate a traverse through it and to stake it out in the field. The typical surveyor is intensely interested in the problem of locating the parcel on the ground, but is frequently not well acquainted with the title person's problems and concerns. Number two, the title person is concerned with ensuring the description and therefore watches closely the calls to and along existing property lines. The typical title person knows little about surveying, but is very concerned about the description's relationship to adjoining parcels. The error the typical surveyor is likely to make is failing to make appropriate title calls. Number three, the judge, of course, is interested in the bottom line. Will it stand the test in court? The judge is also keenly aware of the exact legal meaning of the words used in the description. And here again, the average surveyor has a tendency to use terms without understanding clearly how a court of law may understand them. Do yourself a favor and get in the habit of using the same dictionary the judge uses. You'll find a list of terms in your workbook that are encountered in legal descriptions. They should be studied and understood thoroughly. Again, the books you use should include the ones you'll find in the recommended reading in your workbook. Special attention should be given to words like pedigree and half. We have already talked about pedigree. The word half has two different meanings depending on how it is used. Under state rules, half means area. But if federal rules are to be followed, the word means dividing the sideline dimensions in half and then connecting the midpoints. That rarely results in half by area. Half in a description in California means area unless the description includes language that clearly indicates that the intent is to use federal rules such as a reference to a U.S. government survey. Either is a commonly abused word. It means on one side or the other, and that is almost never what the description writer wants to say. Beginners sometimes describe a strip of land by saying, a strip of land 20 feet wide lying 10 feet on either side of the following described line. That statement describes a 10-foot wide strip on one side or on the other of the described line. The word should be each and not either. It's hard to imagine the word either ever fitting in a legal description. Adjacent, adjoining, and contiguous should be understood also. An easement that touches a property line along its entire length is said to be adjoining, whereas an easement that touches a property line for part of its length and for the rest of the length is close to but not touching is said to be adjacent. Adjoining or adjacent would describe that portion that touches the property line, but adjacent is the only word that describes that portion of the easement that is close to, but not touching, the property line. Learn what the various authorities say about the word contiguous, and you will agree that it is an ambiguous term. It should be avoided in legal descriptions. Accepting and reserving are sometimes used as though they were synonymous. They are not. Accept or accepting have the effect of subtracting something from the parcel just described. A description that describes a 3-acre parcel and then accepts 1 acre conveys 2 acres. The acre described in the exception was taken back or removed from the 3 acres initially described. Reserve or reserving creates a new right, like an easement, for instance, in favor of the grantor. A deed may describe 3 acres and then reserve to the grantor a 40-foot easement along the east property line for ingress and egress to serve another parcel owned by the grantor. The deed still conveys 3 acres to the grantee, but creates an easement over the 3 acres in favor of the grantor. The grantor did not need the easement before because he or she owned the entire parcel. You'll find in your workbook a set of miscellaneous clauses designed to help you handle certain standard situations. Each is a standard grouping of words that has been found to work well for describing certain lines like curves, parallel lines, calls to street sidelines, strips, and so forth. You may as well use these same standard statements. It is simply not necessary or wise to spend precious time trying to invent a way of saying certain things when experienced professionals have spent years perfecting the way to say it. Don't try to compose them from scratch while you are taking the test, and don't try to memorize them. There are simply too many. Rather, index a number of samples from this and other sources so you can turn to them quickly and find a sample that is close to what you need. Then modify it to fit your situation. That's much easier and a whole lot safer. You'll find other samples of handy ways of saying certain things in the books listed under recommended reading, particularly Mr. Waddell's book, Writing Legal Descriptions, which we have already mentioned. Concentrate on getting acquainted with the samples that are available and where and how to find them in a hurry. That will make your work much easier. Now let's go back to the basic outline of a description and take a look at the three components in some detail. The preamble or caption describes the larger parcel out of which the subject parcel is cut. It serves to bring the reader's attention to focus on the immediate surroundings. As such, it includes state, county, city, if any, an existing subdivision, such as section, township, and range and meridian, or lot, block, and tract. It will include the names of the grantor and the grantee and will normally indicate the degree of title conveyed. For instance, the term grants to, with no qualifying language, conveys fee, whereas the statement grants to John Jones an easement for ingress and egress in and to would grant an easement for that purpose. There is an exception to what I have said, and that is a quitclaim deed. The words grantor, grantee, grants to, and such do not appear in a quitclaim deed. And instead of stating the exact title conveyed, it will use words like quitclaim or remise, release, and quitclaim. A quitclaim deed releases whatever interest the signer had, if any. The preamble may include words that limit the conveyance, such as that portion of lot 7, etc., included within a strip of land. The described strip may extend far beyond the borders of lot 7, but the only portion conveyed will be the portion of the strip that falls within lot 7. The preamble may indicate the type of description that follows, such as a line description or a strip description. Now the body of the description. This is where the particulars of the description are found. Most people, when thinking of legal descriptions, think in terms of meets and bounds descriptions, where the description begins at a point on the perimeter of the parcel and then gives a series of bearings and distances around the parcel, back to the point of beginning. A great many descriptions are written that way, but there are a number of other types that are really variations on this basic technique. We'll see some examples of these different types shortly. The term meets and bounds means measurements and boundaries. The bearings and distances constitute the meets, and the bounds or boundaries consist of the title calls that are made throughout the description. It's obvious that a description must close mathematically. A typical meets and bounds description says that it returns to the point of beginning. If the bearings and distances do not return the reader to the point of beginning, everyone knows that a mistake has been made. The description may even be void for want of certainty. It's a good idea to run a traverse through a meets and bounds description once it is written. It will not help you with title calls, but it is indeed a very good feeling to know that the description closes. Courses are the statements used to describe the straight and curved lines that make up the boundary of a parcel. The simple course and the one most of us are familiar with is the uncomplicated straight line. Here are two of them. Thence south 60 degrees east, 65.00 feet. Thence north 40 degrees east, 100.00 feet. The word thence is the right word to use in this situation because it means, in effect, continuing from the previous course. The reader is told to traverse in the direction south 60 degrees east for a distance of 65 feet. The reader is then told to continue from that point north 40 degrees east for a distance of 100 feet. Comparing the two bearings gives the deflection angle between the two courses. In this case, it would be 80 degrees. The reader needs that deflection angle in order to plot it in the office or to stake it out in the field. Now let's take a look at a description of the tangent curve that follows those two courses. Thence easterly, along a tangent curve to the right, having a radius of 50 feet through a central angle of 80 degrees and arc distance of 69.81 feet. The statement describes the curve and its relationship to the previous course. The word tangent defines the curve as being tangent to the previous course. In other words, a radial line to the point where the curve begins is at right angles to the previous course. The term to the right means that a person walking the line would curve to the right when walking from the straight line into the curve. Radius, delta, and length of curve are all given, although only two are needed to set the curve. The third is given for a check. Note that the term arc distance is used to describe the length of curve to make sure that the reader does not assume that the distance should be measured along the chord. The technique we have just described is called the tangent method of describing a curve that is tangent to the previous course because it sets the curve relative to a tangent line that passes through the beginning of the curve. Some prefer another method called the concave method, which uses the direction of concavity of the curve itself as well as the bearing of a radial line to the point where the curve begins. What do we mean by direction of concavity? Well, picture yourself at the midpoint of the curve and facing the radius point of the curve. That is, the center of the circle of which the curve is a part. You are then looking in the direction of concavity. Here is how the same curve would be described using the concave method. To a tangent curve, concave southerly, and having a radius of 50.00 feet, thence easterly along said curve through a central angle of 80 degrees, an arc distance of 69.81 feet. In this drawing, we see a curve that is not tangent to the previous course. This is a different situation because the writer must give enough information and do it clearly enough so that the reader can run a traverse through the description without looking at a map. Let's use both methods to describe this non-tangent curve. First, the tangent method. North 40 degrees east, 100.00 feet to a non-tangent curve. Thence, from a tangent that bears north 60 degrees east, easterly along a curve to the right, having a radius of 50.00 feet, through a central angle of 80 degrees, an arc distance of 69.81 feet. This description starts right out by saying that the curve is not tangent. However, if readers are to calculate traverses through the description or walk through it in the field, they will need to be oriented in the correct direction to set the curve. Therefore, the next statement says, from a tangent that bears north 60 degrees east. That instructs readers to face north 60 degrees east instead of north 40 degrees east, as they would have faced if the curve were tangent to the previous course. The rest of the description proceeds the same as if the curve were tangent. Now let's take a look at the concave method. To the beginning of a non-tangent curve, concave southerly and having a radius of 50.00 feet, to which beginning of curve a radial line bears north 30 degrees west, thence easterly along said curve through a central angle of 80 degrees, an arc distance of 69.81 feet. The unique feature that has been added to this description is the statement, to which beginning of curve a radial line bears north 30 degrees west. This gives the reader the direction to go to reach the radius point of the curve. When the radius, delta, and length are given later, as well as a direction of travel, the picture is complete. Note that the radial bearing given is north 30 degrees west and not south 30 degrees east. A radial line radiates in one direction from the radius point to the point on the curve and not beyond. A prolongation of a radial line is described as just that, a prolongation of a radial line. In the drawing now on the screen, we see a parcel consisting of five courses, all of them straight lines. Two of them are tidal lines, in this case section lines. That means they are lines that exist on recorded maps or documents and are locatable on the ground. The description must call along each of these lines to make sure that it does not overlap the line and encroach on adjoining property. Each of these two courses must include two statements. First, a bearing and distance, and second, a specific call along the section line. Certain bearings and or distances in the description must yield if necessary in order that the description will run along the section lines. The other three courses describe free lines. That simply means that they are free of existing title lines. Admittedly, some of them are more free than others. For instance, line BC is tied to the section line at B, and line DE is connected to the section line at E. But the lines themselves are free. They do not coincide with existing title lines. They are new property lines created by this description. Let's assume that the description begins at the section corner and goes clockwise around the parcel. The person reading the description traces it out either on paper or on the ground by using the angles of intersection shown at B, C, D, and E. Each angle of intersection is derived by comparing the bearings of the two adjoining courses. Those shown at B, C, and D are unchallenged, but the angle of intersection at E must yield, if necessary, to match the true direction of the east line of the section. That means trouble later on, as we'll soon see. In a description reading clockwise around the parcel, the course from D to E will include, of course, a bearing and a distance, but it must also include a call to the east line of said section. That call must be made because the section line is the property line. That tells the reader that the intent is to reach the east line even if the distance just given must yield. Incidentally, if the course from D to E gave a bearing and a distance and added the statement to a point on the east line of said section, distant northerly along said east line, 1,214 feet from the southeast corner of said section, both the bearing and the distance given would have to yield if necessary. That is not just a call to a line, but a call to a specific point on the line, and that call must be honored. Likewise, the call may have given a bearing and distance and the statement to the southeast corner of said section. Here again, the bearing and distance would both have to yield if necessary, and the description would run directly to the section corner. The course from E to the section corner should include a bearing and distance along with a call along said section line to the section corner, or to the point of beginning. In this case, both the bearing and the distance may have to yield. Note that using the bearings and distances alone and ignoring the title calls to and along the east line of the section may place this course in a location other than on the true east line of the section. Free lines must be described in such a way that they are surveyable. That means that they must be based on the strongest possible evidence, which usually means that the free line call should be established early in the description. If this description were written in a counterclockwise direction, starting at the section corner, the free line calls would immediately follow the call along the east line of the section and be set relative to the location of that east line. However, the location of that east line is insecure. Clockwise is the direction to go in this case. Now, the point of beginning. The description must have a point of beginning that is a locatable record point or reference to one. Let's take a look at some possible choices in the drawing now on the screen. The preamble would read like this. That portion of Lot 2, Block B, Tract 1124 in the City of, County of, State of California, according to map recorded in Book 100, pages 16 and 17 of maps in the Office of the County Recorder of said county, described as follows. Then would follow the body of the description, which begins by describing the point of beginning. One way to describe the highlighted portion of Lot 2 is to establish the point of beginning at A and then run clockwise around the parcel. That version would begin by saying, beginning at the southwest corner of said Lot 2. Another version would be to begin the description at B, reference to the northwest corner of Lot 2. It might read like this. Beginning at a point on the west line of said Lot 2, distant thereon south 1 degree west, 100.00 feet from the northwest corner of said Lot 2. Note that the statement, distant thereon south 1 degree west, 100.00 feet from the northwest corner of said Lot 2, is a kind of parenthetical statement that simply gives the exact location of the point of beginning. Note also that we reference the point of beginning to only one lot corner and not to two. It would be tempting to describe the point of beginning as being 100 feet from the northwest corner of Lot 2 and 20 feet from the southwest corner of Lot 2. That, however, would be a double call. If a later survey shows that the true length of the west line of the lot is longer or shorter than 120 feet, the reader is forced to decide which one to use or whether to prorate the difference. Double calls are ambiguous and should be avoided. A third way of doing it would be to commence at G and establish a true point of beginning at B. We see this method highlighted on the screen now. It might read like this. Commencing at the northwest corner of Lot 1 of said tract 1124, thence along the west line of said lot, south 1 degree west, 105.00 feet, thence north 88 degrees east, 66.00 feet to the west line of said Lot 2 and the true point of beginning. The conveyance begins at the true point of beginning. The line from the point of commencement to the true point of beginning is simply a means of locating and orienting the description relative to a secure line that can be located on the ground. This technique establishes the basis of bearings on the west line of Lot 1 instead of the west line of Lot 2. There may actually be several courses between the point of commencement and the true point of beginning, depending on the nature of the parcel. If the description then runs clockwise around the parcel from the true point of beginning, the free line call, BC, is based on the west line of Lot 1, which is an advantage if the location of the lot lines for Lot 2 are in doubt. That would not seem to be a problem in a subdivision like that shown in this drawing. However, it's easy to picture more complex parcels where this principle might apply. When looking for the best point to use for the point of beginning, be sure to check the pedigree of each corner to see which one is strong enough to use without fear that its location can be proven wrong. Remember that a found monument does not mean that the location of that corner is secure unless the monument is an original or its pedigree is such that it can be traced back to the original. If such a corner cannot be found, the writer should consider a type of description that will permit free line calls to be tied to sound points outside the parcel. The writer must establish a sound basis of bearings based on points and lines whose location is secure. The figure on the screen presents two choices for a basis of bearings, the south line of the section and the east line. The south line is chosen because the two monuments that control the line are original and unlikely to be successfully challenged. The east quarter corner is calculated, which means that someone may later prove our location wrong. A basis of bearings assigns a bearing to a line whose location is known so that that relationship may be used to orient the rest of the description. Different maps and deeds may use different bearings for the same title line. This is a place where mistakes are easily made. For instance, it is easy to convince ourselves that once the point of beginning, in this case the southeast corner of the section, is described, all we need to do is say westerly along the south line of the section, 800 feet or whatever distance was needed, and then continue around the parcel. The direction of the section line, after all, is determined by the monuments and not by the bearing we may assign to it. The reader could find the point of beginning and traverse westerly along the section line the 800 feet, but then the reader is stuck. With no bearing given for the section line, the reader has no way of calculating the angle of intersection to turn off the section line to give direction to the next course. The person staking out the description in the field needs those angles of intersection between courses, and they are obtained by comparing the bearings of the adjoining courses as they appear in the description. Beware of the second basis of bearings, however. A second basis of bearings is established as shown in the figure now on the screen when a call is made to and then along a tidal line in the body of the description, and the true location of that tidal line is different from that indicated by the bearing used in the description. In other words, the relationship between the line and the bearing assigned to it is different from that established in the initial intended basis of bearings. In this drawing, the point of beginning and the basis of bearings are properly established along the one secure line. However, a call is made along the east line of the section, which is not secure. If that line is not where the writer thought it was, a new basis of bearings has been established. Assume for the moment that the corridor we see crossing this section continues on into the next section to the east. Suppose also that the description for the parcel to the east uses the insecure section line for a basis of bearings. The two descriptions will fit neatly together only if the section line is exactly where the writer thought it was. The distance between the section corner and the point where the north line of the corridor crosses the section line would be exactly the same in each description. If, however, the section line is really found to be in a different place, the distance between the section from the section corner to the north line of the corridor will be different in the two descriptions. In other words, there will be an unintended jog in the northerly line of the corridor. This drawing shows the difference between the calculated position for the east line of the section and the true line as determined by a later survey. What portion of the area between the calculated and the true line actually conveys? Do we prolong AB to C? Do we go at right angles to the calculated line from B to D? Or do we go at right angles to the true line from B to E? Prolonging the line AB to C is the probable answer. Remember that if one bearing or one distance has to yield, the traverse will no longer close mathematically. Yet the description will clearly convey to the section line wherever it is found to be. The challenge is to write a description that will convey to the section line and at the same time make sure that the free lines are definitely set relative to the sound basis of bearings. In this case, the south line of the section. There are a number of ways of accomplishing that goal. We'll see a couple of them shortly. The next course is along the section line, which is now the true line and not the calculated one. The course that follows this one presents a problem. We see here that the angle of intersection at the point where the description leaves the true line results in a direction for the succeeding course that is different from that intended by the writer. A different technique is needed to enable the writer to describe the free lines that follow in a more secure fashion. We are presented with a challenge when a call for a free line follows a call along a line whose location is somewhat uncertain, as we see here. The best answer in this case would be a different type of description, such as an exception or inclusive description. More about that later. Clauses are separate statements that are normally added after the body of the description. Their purpose is to qualify or augment what has been said thus far. A clause may state the area of the parcel described or may state where a basis of bearings is intended to be. Another one that is used in strip descriptions to clarify where the sidelines of the strip are to terminate reads like this. The sidelines of said strip shall be prolonged or shortened so as to terminate at the east line of said property. A clause may be needed to reserve a right such as an easement for ingress and egress. A reservation, remember, creates a new right which the grantor will retain when the fee is conveyed to the grantee. Augmenting clauses add something to what has been described, such as a means of access to the parcel described. Another would be a statement indicating what portion of the underlying fee in the adjoining street is intended to be conveyed. You will find samples of these and other clauses in your workbook. Now we'll talk about the different types of descriptions. There are really different techniques that are available for us to use depending on the need. Think of them as a toolbox full of tools to use on the job. Sectionalized land refers to land that was subdivided by the federal government while it was in public domain. The land was surveyed in accordance with federal law, and plats of those surveys were prepared for use in identifying the land and to aid in conveying it to private parties and various government agencies. However, the plats were based on the survey and dependent on it. The location of the original monuments constitute the final proof of the size, shape, and location of a given parcel, even though the size and shape may be considerably different from that shown on the plat. Descriptions in sectionalized land contain the section in which the parcel is located, the township, which tells how far north or south of the initial point the parcel is, the range, which tells how far east or west of the initial point the parcel is, the meridian, which identifies the initial point and the meridian passing through it, the official plat, including the approval date, city, if any, county, and state. There are three initial points in the state of California. Their locations were chosen arbitrarily by the original government surveyor. You see their general location on the screen now. Every sectionalized land description in the state is referenced to one of these three points. Let's take a closer look at one of them. The highlighted square is called a township, and it is described as being Township 3 South, Range 3 West, commonly abbreviated T3SR3W. That means that it is located three townships south of the initial point and three west of it. A description of this township would read, Township 3 South, Range 3 West, San Bernardino Meridian, or Mount Diablo or Humboldt Meridian, in the city of, if any, the county of, state of California, according to official plat thereof, approved, and the approval date. The approval date of the official plat is important. There may be a number of plats, and it is important to be clear which one we are referring to. There would be an original plat, there may be a later independent resurvey, and following that, a dependent resurvey, and there may even be a corrective dependent resurvey. description writing problems in the LS exam may not furnish an approval date. In that case, you will have to accept what they give you and ignore the date. Each normal township is broken down further in the following manner. A normal township contains 36 sections numbered beginning at the northeast corner of the township and running westerly across the township, then south one tier, and then easterly across the township, and so forth until 36 is reached at the southeast corner. If we highlight certain digits, we will notice an interesting sequence that should make it easier to remember which sections are on the perimeter of the township. Note the sequence of the numbers highlighted in blue, beginning at section 1. First clockwise along the east side, then counterclockwise, beginning again at section 1. Then, remembering the direction in which the sections are numbered, as indicated by the yellow arrows on the screen, it's an easy matter to number all of the sections. Section 22 is highlighted on the screen. The description of the township we have just talked about can be easily adapted to describe Section 22 by simply adding it to the description, usually in front of it. Here we have a closer look at the southwest quarter of Section 22, broken into aliquot parts with the northeast quarter of the southwest quarter highlighted. We can easily expand our description further to describe only this highlighted area. It would read, the northeast quarter of the southwest quarter of Section 22, Township 3 South, Range 3 West, San Bernardino Meridian, in the city of, county of, state of California, according to official plat thereof, approved, and the approval date. Remember that the easy way to read a description like this, or to write one for that matter, is to read or write it backwards. That description will locate that particular parcel with reference to the San Bernardino initial point. It is unique in that it will describe only one parcel, although a good deal of surveying would be necessary to mark it out in the field. The excess and deficiency resulting from the survey of the interior of the township was placed in the sections along the north and west lines of the township. This resulted in portions of those sections being other than the intended size and shape. They were assigned lot numbers. A description of one of these would read, Lot 3 in the northwest quarter of Section 3, instead of the northeast quarter of the northwest quarter of Section 3. Perhaps the simplest description of all is the map reference description. It describes a parcel as shown on a particular map. Calling for that map has the effect of incorporating that entire map, if necessary, into the description, just as if it were printed on the face of the document. Anything on the map may be used to locate the parcel on the ground. Descriptions of this kind are short and easy to write. This one would read, Lot 1, Block B, Tract 1124, in the city of, county of, state of California, according to a map recorded in Book 100, pages 16 and 17 of maps, in the office of the county recorder of said county. Note that in this description, the preamble and body are combined in one statement. One advantage in a description like this is that it is short and easy to write. It also gives the reader the authority to use the entire map, if necessary, to locate the parcel. One disadvantage is the fact that the description does not give the reader a picture of the size and shape of the parcel. The reader must have the map to see that. Another disadvantage is the fact that if the lot number or the block designation were incorrect, the result would be disastrous. Now we've about reached the halfway point in our presentation, so let's take a short break. Welcome back. Let's continue our overview of the various types of descriptions and how they are used. Here we have a meets and bounds description which gives all of the dimensions and angular relationships of the sides. It might read like this. That portion of Lot 2, Block B, Tract 1124, in the city of, county of, state of California, according to map recorded in Book 100, pages 16 and 17 of maps, in the office of the county recorder of said county, described as follows. Beginning at the southwest corner of said Lot 2, thence along the west line of said Lot 2, a bearing and a distance. Thence, a bearing and a distance to the east line of said Lot 2. Thence, along said east line, a bearing and a distance to the southeast corner of said Lot 2. Thence, along the south line of said Lot 2, a bearing and a distance to the point of beginning. Note that the point of beginning is a record point that both the surveyor and the title person should be able to find. The basis of bearings is established along the west line of the lot. Remember that anything on that map may be used to locate that line. The free line call, the one that crosses the lot, is located by turning the deflection angle derived from comparing the bearings of the first two courses. Note again that if the description had given only a general direction along the west line of the lot, like northerly along the west line of said lot, and then a bearing for the free line call, the reader would not be able to get that deflection angle. The distance in the free line call would have to yield if necessary in order to reach the east line as stated in the description. Here again, the call was simply to the lot line and not to a specific point, such as a lot corner, or a point on the line a certain distance from one of the corners. The last two courses follow along the title lines whether the bearings and distances given fit or not. A strip description describes a grantor's property and then describes a strip of land that will cross the property. The description says that any portion of the strip that falls on the grantor's property will be conveyed to the grantee. If the grant is an easement, that is what is conveyed. The strip is usually based on points and lines outside the subject property. It is not necessary to know exactly where the grantor's property lines are. A description of the strip on Lot 3, as highlighted on the screen, might read like this. That portion of Lot 3, Block B, Tract 1124, in the city of, county of, state of California, according to map recorded in Book 100, pages 16 and 17 of maps, in the office of the county recorder of said county, included within a strip of land 20.00 feet wide, line 10.00 feet on each side of the following described line. Beginning at a point on the west line of said tract 1124, distant along said west line, bearing and a distance, from the southwest corner of said tract. Thence, a bearing and a distance to a point on the east line of said tract 1124. Distant along said east line, bearing and a distance from the southeast corner of said tract. Note that we said each side of the line and not either. Remember that the word either means one or the other, which is certainly not our intent. It is not necessary to add a clause stating that the sideline should be prolonged or shortened so as to terminate at the lot lines, because that portion of the entire strip that falls within the lot will convey. Now the of descriptions. The word of is used because it is a vital ingredient in all the descriptions of this type. This type of description is designed to create a strip of land of fixed width along one border of a parcel. For instance, the southerly 10 feet of Lot 2 is understood to create a strip of land 10 feet wide, measured at right angles, bounded on the south by the south line of the lot. The 10 feet might be measured along one of the lot lines instead of at right angles, in which case the description should so state. Of descriptions, sometimes use area instead of distance as control. For instance, a description reading, the south 2.00 acres of, applied to a four-sided parcel with each of the sides being close to a cardinal direction, would be understood to set the north line of the 2 acres parallel with the south line of the parcel. When the shape of the parcel is irregular, however, this type is hard to interpret. Another form of description is the proportional type, such as the south half of lot 2. The word half, again, means area. And again, the north line of the south half would be set parallel with the south line of the lot in cases where the lot lines are close to a cardinal direction. If they are not in nearly cardinal directions, or if the parcel is irregular in shape, a description like this may be subject to more than one interpretation. A line description is one that takes all of a grantor's property, wherever it is, lying a certain direction from a described line which normally originates and ends outside the grantor's property. The advantage is that the free line calls can be located with precision, even though the grantor's property lines may not. The one we see highlighted might be described like this. That portion of lot 3, line northerly of the following described line. Then would follow a description of the line beginning on the tract boundary on the west and ending on the tract boundary on the east, similar to the way we did in the strip description. This description would take any portion of lot 3 that fell northerly of that line, whether the lot lines could be located or not. This same described line can be used for each parcel that the line crosses. Only the lot number or other parcel identification would have to change. The same is true for strip descriptions. The exception method describes more property than is intended, and then the unneeded portion is excepted, which in effect subtracts it from the description. It has the advantage of making it possible to create new property lines in a secure fashion. This method works very well in the drawing now on the screen, where the south line of the section is secure, but the east line is not. The body of the description can describe the highlighted portion, including the small remainder in the southeast corner of the section. Then that small remainder can be excepted out. The net result is what we now see on the screen. This technique makes it possible for each of the two sets of free line calls to be described individually, each one clearly based on the south line of the section. Neither is compromised in any way by the necessary call along the uncertain east line of the section. Now, the inclusive type of description. This technique is also used to create surveyable free line calls where the location of one or more tidal lines is uncertain. The preamble says, in effect, that portion of the owner's property, such as the southeast quarter of section 11, included within the following described parcel. Then the new parcel is described deliberately extending it safely beyond the tidal line whose location is uncertain. This technique can be used even if all of the grantor's property lines are uncertain as to location. The new parcel is deliberately designed to extend beyond or overlap all of the grantor's property lines that are affected. The new parcel itself, of course, is based on a line that is secure. The way to convey to the tidal line, wherever it may be, but at the same time, the effect is to convey to the tidal line wherever it may be, but at the same time, it creates new property lines, the free line calls that are surveyable and not compromised in any way by the location of the uncertain tidal line. This type of description is really a last resort technique, but there are occasions when it is appropriate. The bearings and distances listed in the body of the description would describe the parcel that extends beyond the property line, but the portion actually conveyed would end at the property line. The exception method can also be used in this case. The preamble would state, that portion of the southeast quarter of Section 11 described as follows. Then the overlapping parcel would be described as in the inclusive method. Following that, a statement would be added, excepting therefrom any portion lying within Section 12. You need a plan before beginning to write. Here are some basic questions that must be answered before beginning the task of writing. You are less likely to make errors if you systematically think your way through these questions before actually writing the description. They won't all apply in every case, but it is good to get in the habit of systematically considering each question to make sure nothing important is overlooked. Number one, what kind of description is best? Number two, what kind for the adjoining parcels? Number three, what point is best for the point of beginning? Number four, where should the basis of bearings be established? Number five, clockwise or counterclockwise? Number six, what calls should be made? Number seven, what clauses need to be added? Let's take a quick look at each of the seven questions to make sure that we understand them. Number one, what kind of description is best? We've illustrated a number of types of descriptions that can be used depending on the need. We've referred to them as tools in our toolbox. If one doesn't fit, perhaps another will. Number two, what kind for the adjoining parcels? When describing the right-of-way for facilities like utilities or roads, the requirements cross many property lines. The techniques you use for two adjoining parcels need to be compatible. If the descriptions for two adjoining parcels describe a common point on the property line in two different ways, you are likely to wind up with a sawtooth right-of-way. Number three, what point is best for the point of beginning? Remember that the point of beginning must be a record point or reference to one, and there must be no doubt about its location. The basis of bearings is normally established in the course that follows and the free line calls immediately after that, if possible. Number four, where should the basis of bearings be established? Both ends of the line used for the basis of bearings should be secure, and not just one. If the location of the entire description, is dependent on the location of the basis of bearings. Remember that the free line call should be made immediately after the basis of bearings, if possible. Remember also that a bearing is a relative statement that has no meaning to the surveyor unless it can be related to a line in the field. Be sure to give a bearing for the line you have chosen for the basis of bearings and not just a general direction like easterly. Question number five, clockwise or counterclockwise? Some people are under the impression that meets and bounds descriptions must be written in a clockwise fashion. That is not true. In fact, clockwise is sometimes the wrong way to go. Remember that the free line calls need to be based securely on the best evidence, which is normally the basis of bearings. Have you ever heard someone say that they took the LS exam and did pretty well, but they failed to establish the basis of bearings on a description writing problem? I have, and I've heard it a number of times. Number six, what calls should be made? Remember we said that one of the errors the average surveyor is most likely to make is the failure to make appropriate title calls. Here is your chance to correct that. systematically go through the description with this very question in mind. That way you won't overlook an important call. Number 7, what clauses need to be added? There may be a need for an area clause, a special basis of bearings clause, or a clause to clarify what happens to the sidelines of a strip of land. Don't take a chance on overlooking one that is needed. Now let's take a look at some sample descriptions and plan the task using the 7 questions we've just introduced. What better place to get the sample questions than the LS exams from previous years? We'll study a number of them, beginning with the 1977 exam. You have copies of these problems as they appeared on the exams in your workbook. You will also find a copy of the planning the task list of questions there. You may want to stop the tape now and find them so you will have them before you as we go. You'll find it helpful because the drawings we show on the screen have been edited a bit. Ready? Okay, let's go. 1977 exam, problem C4. The drawing is described as a parcel of land identified as tract 1 of Mann subdivision per map book 3, page 17, records of such and such a county, California. We are further told that the bearings and distances not shown are not to be assumed or calculated, and we are to disregard possible requirements for a parcel map. We are to write a meets and bounds description for each of the 3 parcels to be cut out of the tract. We can assume that all of the lot lines and corners are good, so we don't have to be concerned about pedigree of corners in this problem. Not all of the 7 questions will apply here, but it is good practice to get in the habit of checking each one. We're required to write a meets and bounds description for each of the 3, so question number 1 has been answered for us. Question 2, what kind for the adjoining parcels, and number 7, what clauses need to be added, do not apply here and can be disregarded. The remaining 4 questions do apply, however, and need to be considered. Let's apply each of the 4 questions to each of the 3 parcels. Parcel A. A preamble is called for in this one. It would read like this. That portion of Tract 1 of Mann subdivision, according to map recorded in Book 3, page 17 of maps in the official records of such and such a county, California, described as follows. Now, question number 3. What point is best for the point of beginning? The point of beginning must be at or related to one of the tract corners. It really could be any of the tract corners, but the BC and EC of the curve, as well as the most northerly corner, would lead to some awkward wording. The south line of parcel A is tied to the southwest and southeast corners, so we'll have to refer to them anyway in order to set the south line of parcel A. Let's use one of them and describe it as follows. Beginning at a point on the northwesterly line of said tract 1, distant northeasterly along said line 510.00 feet from the southwesterly corner of said tract. This sets the point of beginning at a point on the northwesterly line of the tract referenced to the southwest corner of the tract, a record corner that will satisfy the surveyor, the title person, and the judge. Question number 4, where should the basis of bearings be established? Actually, a basis of bearings in the conventional sense is not needed on this parcel because the south line of the parcel will be set between 2 fixed points, and all of the other courses will be along existing tidal lines. There are no bearings used except the general directions like northerly, northwesterly, etc. The normal place to begin a basis of bearings, to establish a basis of bearings, would be the northwest line of the tract where a direction is given from the tract corner to the point of beginning. Here again, if there were bearings on each of the straight lines on the tract boundary and a calculated bearing on the south line of parcel A, it would be essential to give the bearing of the northwesterly line of the tract and not just the general direction, northeasterly, so that the angle of intersection between the tract line and the south line of parcel A can be determined. Number 5, clockwise or counterclockwise. Either would work in this case, but it is good to get in the habit of describing free line calls first, so I would choose counterclockwise. Number 6, what calls should be made? A call must be made to a specific point on the east line of the track, just as in describing the POB, and calls must be made along the track boundary wherever the description traversed it. A description might read like this after describing the POB. Thence easterly to a point on the east line of said tract, distant northerly along said east line, 350.00 feet from the southeast corner of said tract. Thence northerly along said east line to the most northerly corner of said tract. Thence westerly and southwesterly along the general northerly and northwesterly line of said tract to the point of beginning. Parcel B. Question number 3. What point is best for the point of beginning? It would be natural to use the southwest corner of the tract for the point of beginning, but when we think ahead to question number 6, what calls to make, we will see an advantage to doing it a little differently. The only way we have of describing the curve forming the northeasterly line of the parcel is to describe it as passing through two specific points, one on the northwesterly line of the tract and the other on the southerly line. Let's describe the POB as beginning at a point on the southerly line of said tract 1, distant easterly 300.00 feet along said southerly line from the southwest corner of said tract 1. Question 4. Where should the basis of bearings be established? Again, this is not needed because the one free line is tied to two fixed points. The normal place for the basis of bearings, however, would be the south line of the tract. Question 5. Clockwise or counterclockwise? Since we have already begun on the south line of the tract, we will have to go clockwise in order to set the point on the northwesterly line of the tract. If we had begun at that point on the northwesterly line of the tract, we would have had to go counterclockwise. Number 6, what calls should be made? The two points through which the curve passes must be specifically described in one way or another. Also, calls must be made along the two track lines, and the track corner must be called because the curve passes through points that are tied to the corner. The portion of the description that follows the point of beginning might read like this. Thence westerly along said southerly line, 300.00 feet to the southwest corner of said tract 1. Thence northeasterly along the northwesterly line of said tract 1, 350.00 feet to a non-tangent curve, concave southwesterly, having a radius of 500.00 feet. Said curve also passing through the point of beginning. Thence southeasterly along said curve to the point of beginning. Parcel C. Beginning with question number 3 again. What point is best for the point of beginning? Here again, we'll have to be a bit creative as we were in parcel B. The only controls we have here are the four distances, the location of the track corner, and the two track lines. There is no direction given for the two sides with lengths of 147 feet and 210 feet. So the distances themselves we'll have to control. In order to do that, we will have to tie those two sides to fixed points on the two track lines. Let's begin at the southwest corner of parcel C. It may sound like this. beginning at a point on the south line of said Tract 1, distant westerly along said south line, 200.00 feet from the southeast corner of said tract. Number 4, where should the basis of bearings be established? Same answer as in Parcel B. No bearings are used, so none is needed. Number 5, clockwise or counterclockwise? Our point of beginning has set one of the control points, which will control the location of the northerly and westerly sides, but we must set the other one before those two sides can be described. We'll have to go counterclockwise in this case. Note that if we had placed the point of beginning on the east line of the tract, we would have had to go clockwise. Number 6, what calls should be made? The tract corner and the two tract lines. Again, the two specific points on the tract lines need to be described in one way or another. The portion of the description following the point of beginning might read like this. Thence easterly, along said south line of said tract, 200.00 feet to the southeast corner of said tract. Thence northerly, along the east line of said tract, 150.00 feet. Thence westerly, 210.00 feet to a point that is distant 147.00 feet from the point of beginning. Thence southerly, 147.00 feet to the point of beginning. 1978 exam, problem C1. We're asked to calculate dimensions and write a legal description for that portion of the south half of the southeast quarter of the southeast quarter of section 22 lying east of Pratt Road. Dimensions are given to and along the center line of the road. So dimensions to and along the east line of the road will have to be calculated. I'll leave that part to you. But we can plan the task by asking our questions of the parcel before we start to write. Number 1, what kind of parcel of a description is best? The problem calls for a meets and bounds description. A line description would be tempting otherwise. It would read, that portion of the south half of the southeast quarter of the southeast quarter of section 22 lying east of Pratt Road as described in deed, etc. Question 2, what kind for the adjoining parcels? To truly locate the subject parcel, we would have to properly break down the section, which would require more than the one monument shown. We must assume for the purposes of this problem that the dimensions and bearings of the sides of this parcel are correct as shown. If there were some question as to the true location of the north line of the subject parcel, then when writing a description for the parcel just north of ours, we would have to be careful so that we would not end up with two locations for the intersection of the east line of the road and the north line of the subject parcel. Number 3, what point is best for the point of beginning? As we've just stated, the true location of the north line of the south half of the southeast quarter of the southeast quarter of any section is dependent on the section breakdown, which in turn is dependent on several monuments. A line like that is not normally a good place to start a description. The section corner is the obvious place to begin. Number 4, where should the basis of bearings be established? The south line of the section looks good because then we can describe the sideline of the road immediately after establishing the basis of bearings. Remember that in order to establish a basis of bearings, we will have to say along the south line of said section and also give the bearing of the line south 89 degrees 32 minutes west. Just calling along the section line, even with a general direction, is not enough. Number 5, clockwise or counterclockwise? It really would not matter since every course in this description will be along an existing tidal line. In other words, there are no free line calls that need to be based clearly on the basis of bearings. An old habit, however, would lead me to go clockwise so that the new property line, the east line of the existing Pratt Road, could be described immediately after the basis of bearings. Number six, what calls should be made? The section corner would have to be described, of course. The monument could be described if desired, but it is not necessary. A call for a physical monument is a double call and usually results in more trouble than it is worth. The first call, first course, would have to call along the section line and to the east line of the road, as described in the deed that created it. The next three courses would have to call along the east line of that road, and the last of those three courses would have to call to the north line of the south half of the southeast quarter of the southeast quarter of the section, which is the property line. The following course would have to call along that north line to the east line of the section. The last course would have to call along said east line of the section to the point of beginning. All of the distances and all of the bearings except the one in the south line of the section would have to yield if necessary because of these title calls. Number seven. What clauses need to be added? The problem states that area is not required and there doesn't appear to be a need for any others. Now the 1984 exam, problem D5. We're asked here to write a description for a 20-acre parcel in the northeast quarter of section 11. The drawing indicates that no monument was found for the northwest corner of the section, but the other section corner monuments and all of the quarter corner monuments were found. Note that the only monuments needed to break out the northeast quarter of the section are the four quarter corner monuments and the one at the northeast corner of the section. The dimensions also indicate that it is a conveniently square standard section, so we can conclude that normal federal breakdown procedures can be followed. The description would read, the west half of the northwest quarter of the northeast quarter of section 11, township 10 south, range 2 west, Mount Diablo Meridian, in the county of Santa Cruz, state of California, as shown on the official plat thereof, on file in the office of the Bureau of Land Management. There should be an approval date for the official plat, but none is given. 1984 exam, problem D6. Here we have four situations where our list of questions really do not apply. These are the kinds we refer to as of descriptions because that word is always a key ingredient. There are some important rules and principles to learn, however. So let's take a look at the drawings one at a time and learn what to look for and what techniques work. Number one, our first drawing is a parallelogram to be divided in half by area. The west half is to be conveyed first and the east half later. The real challenge here is how to describe the dividing line in such a way that each of the two descriptions would place it in the same location. Remember that there is no fixed rule in state law that dictates, for instance, where the east line of the west half should be placed. It must result in dividing the parcel in half by area, but that's all the law requires. Good surveying practice recommends certain procedures depending on the nature of the parcel. Note that the left and right side lines are not parallel. That could lead to some confusion as to where to place the dividing line if a simple description, the west one half of lot 7, were used. Some would make the dividing line parallel with the west line of the lot, but others would use a mean of the bearings for the west and east lines of the lot. Therefore, it is important to specify exactly how to set that dividing line and use the same language in each of the two descriptions. We might say this for the first parcel conveyed. The west one half of lot 7, the east line being parallel with the west line of said lot. The second parcel conveyed then would read like this. The east one half of lot 7, the west line of said east one-half being parallel with the west line of said lot. Number two, the first description. The north 75.00 feet of lot 10 of, etc., would do the job. That language would result in the south line being parallel with the north line of the lot. Second description. The north line of this piece is not parallel with the south line of the lot because the east and west lines of the piece are both 75 feet and the two lines are not nearly parallel. We could say that portion of lot 10 lying southerly of a line connecting a point on the east line of said lot, distant northerly along said east line, 75.00 feet from the southeast corner of said lot, with a point on the west line of said lot, distant along said west line, northerly 75.00 feet from the southwest corner of said lot. Or we could write a meets and bounds description beginning at either of the two southerly lot corners and running in either direction around the parcel using general directions and calls along the lot lines where appropriate. It would also cite the two 75-foot dimensions where they apply. The third description. This conveyance would include whatever is left. It would read like this, lot 10 of whatever, except the north 75.00 feet of said lot. Also accepting that portion thereof described as follows. Here you would repeat what was said in the second deed. Number three, the first description gets to set the dividing line and the other deed will describe what was left. This is how it might sound. First one would read, the east 4.15 acres of lot 3 of whatever. The second would read, lot 3 of, etc., except the east 4.15 acres thereof. The west line of the 4.15 acres would be set parallel with the east line of the lot because that line is nearly cardinal in direction. The location of the east line of the west half of this lot would be unclear because the west line of the lot is not nearly in a cardinal direction. Number four, note that this lot is somewhat near square and the opposite sides look parallel. It's the southeasterly 2 acres that need to be described. Note also that the problem is only worth 2 points. An inexperienced writer could easily spend much more time on this one than the 2 points are worth. We'll have to be a bit creative with this one. Note that the opposite sides of the 2 acre parcel seem to be parallel, and all 4 sides seem to be about the same length. Perhaps we can use those facts in composing a description. The southeasterly 2.0 acres of lot 13 of the southerly and easterly sidelines of said 2 acre parcel being of equal length and the northerly and westerly sidelines being parallel with the southerly and easterly lines respectively of said lot. The remainder of the lot would be described as lot 13 of, etc., except, and then describe the 2 acre parcel. 1986 exam, problem A3. The problem described an approved tentative parcel map with the final parcel map waived. In other words, we can forget about the parcel map. The problem is to write 4 separate descriptions in such a way that they are compatible with one another. One is for a proposed county road, which is to be recorded first, and the other 3 are for 3 proposed parcels that are to abut upon the road. The problem further states that the bearings and dimensions shown are either record or calculated from record and do not come from a survey. The descriptions are to be written in such a way that if a later survey found the bearings and dimensions to be different, the descriptions would still fit neatly together. Let's apply the 7 questions from the planning the task section to the description required for the road easement, since that one has to be recorded first. What kind of description is best? Number one, the road easement is a strip of land of uniform width using a dimension center line. The obvious choice is to use a strip description. Number two, what kind for the adjoining parcels? All of the 3 other descriptions will abut upon the road. In fact, since the road is an easement, the center line of the road will be the property line between parcel 3 on one side and parcels 1 and 2 on the other. Since the road easement will be recorded first, any number of types of description could be used for the other 3. Number 3, what point is best for the point of beginning? It could start at the point where the center line intersects the north line or the south line of existing lot 18. Whichever point is chosen, it should be referenced to one of the lot corners. If the description begins at the south line, your description will have to begin with a curve. Note that the radial bearing is given there. It might be easier to begin at the point on the north line of the lot. Number 4. Where should the basis of bearings be established? Here is an easy place to make a mistake by failing to properly establish a basis of bearings. It should normally be established in the first course. We might say, beginning at a point on the north line of said lot 18, distant along said line, north 89 degrees east, 240.00 feet from the northwest corner of said lot 18. Failing to give the bearing along the north line would be a mistake. Number 5, clockwise or counterclockwise? This question really does not apply in this case. Number 6, what calls should be made? The basis of bearings should call along whichever lot line is used, and at the end of the description, the call must be made to the other lot line. What clauses should be added? A clause should be added explaining how and where the sidelines of the strip are to terminate. The clause is needed here because the described line terminates at the lot line, and some might assume that the sidelines should terminate at a line at right angles or radially to the center line, passing through the point of termination. There we have it. The preamble would not mention the parcel map because it does not exist. The parcel would be described as a portion of lot 18, tract 400, etc. Now for parcel 1. Question number 1. What kind of description is best? Most people would choose a meets and bounds description, so let's use that. A line description could be used as well, calling for that portion of said lot 18, line westerly of the previously recorded road easement, and northerly of the following described line, and then follow with a description of the common line between parcels 1 and 2. Question 2, what kind for the adjoining parcel? This is an important question for this parcel because the line between it and parcel 2 must fall in the same location from each of the descriptions, even if a later survey showed that the bearings and dimensions we are using are wrong. The only way to make sure that the south line of parcel 1 will be in the same place as the north line of parcel 2 is to use the same identical language in each description. We should use a meets and bounds description for parcel 2 as well, but the point of beginning, the basis of bearings, and the description of the common line must be identical in each description. Number 3, point of beginning. The point of beginning should be the west end of the common line referenced to one of the lot corners. Let's call it a point on the common line. Let's call it a point on the west line of said lot 18, distant along said line, north 1 degree west, 150.00 feet from the southwest corner of lot 18. Number four, basis of bearings. The basis of bearings should be the west line of lot 18 and should include a call along the line as well as a bearing and distance. Number five, clockwise or counterclockwise? Counterclockwise, so that the free line call, the common line, is described first. Number six, what calls should be made? To and along the center line of the road easement, to and along the north line of the lot, and to and along the west line back to the point of beginning. Number seven, what clauses need to be added? None. Parcel two. We've already shown that the same identical language should be used here for the point of beginning, the basis of bearings, and the description of the common line. Therefore, this one must read in a clockwise direction, and calls made to and along the center line of the road easement, and then to and along the south and west lines of the lot back to the point of beginning. If line descriptions were decided on for parcels 1 and 2, the common line would be described in the same way, tying it to a point on the west line of lot 18, distant the same bearing and distance from the same lot corner in each case. Then the description for parcel 1 would read, that portion of lot 18, etc., line westerly of the road and line northerly of the following described line. The one for parcel 2 would read the same, except for the fact that it would read southerly of the following described line instead of northerly. Parcel 3. This one could be a line description calling for that portion of lot 18 lying easterly of the road, or it could be a meets and bounds description beginning at one of the lot corners and reading in either direction with calls to and along all the lot lines and the road. 1991 exam, problem B1. Here's another good test for our list of seven questions. It is also an occasion to use the miscellaneous clauses you have in your workbook. Using standard language to describe some of the tricky situations we face will make your work much easier. Let's go through the questions. Number one, what kind of description is best? That question has really been decided for us in this case. It will have to be a strip description. Remember, however, that there are a number of ways of describing a strip of land, as you will see in miscellaneous clauses section of your workbook. It would be helpful to quickly review the possibilities before writing. For instance, the center line of the strip can be described, but that would necessitate a call to a parallel line towards the end of the description. It is also possible to use a sideline description using the right-hand sideline of the strip looking in the direction of the traverse. That would eliminate the need to call to a parallel line. However, you will find a sample of a call to a parallel line in your workbook. So let's use the center line. Some of the data needs to be calculated, of course. Number two, what kind for adjoining parcels? We're not required to write any of the adjoining descriptions, but if and when they were written, they would certainly be strip descriptions as well. Number three, what point is best for the point of beginning? The problem requires that we begin the description at the southwest corner of section 5, so that much is decided for us. However, the actual conveyance begins east of there where the strip intersects the south line of the section. So let's use the section corner as the point of commencement and the point where the conveyance begins as the true point of beginning. Here's how the preamble and the first course might be written. That portion of the southwest quarter of section 5, township 7 north, range 12 east, Mount Diablo Meridian, according to official plat thereof, consisting of a strip of land 40.00 feet wide, line 20.00 feet on each side of the following described line. Commencing at the southwest corner of said section 5, thence east 441.00 feet along the south line of said section to the true point of beginning. The next course may be a challenge for some because it requires describing a non-tangent curve to start the strip description. That can be a bit intimidating for inexperienced writers, but remember, it's in the book. Once again, your workbook has samples of how this is done. Find a sample that seems to fit the situation and adapt it to fit. Number four, where should the basis of bearings be established? The basis of bearings was established when we called along the section line and gave a bearing as well. Number five, clockwise or counterclockwise? This question really applies only in meets and bounds descriptions. Number six, what calls should be made? The southwest corner of the section, the south line of the section, the south line of parcel A of the parcel map, and the west line of the section. The call to the south line of parcel A of the parcel map must result in the strip abutting upon the south line of parcel A. Number seven, what clauses need to be added? We'll need to add a clause to make sure that the sidelines of the strip begin and end where we want them to. Again, there are samples in the workbook. It might sound like this. The sidelines of said strip at the beginning of said description shall be continued or shortened as necessary so as to begin at the south line of said section, and at the end of said description, said sidelines shall be prolonged or shortened as necessary so as to terminate at the west line of said section. Note that we used the term continued at the beginning of the strip and the word prolonged at the end. This is because curved lines are continued and straight lines are prolonged. Well, there you have it. The planning the task exercise should help you think through the major problems you will encounter before you start to write. Not all of the questions will apply in every case, but it's good to get in the habit of going through the checklist every time. Also, remember again to get acquainted with as many standard, acceptable, tested ways of saying certain things as you can. You'll find a number of them in your workbook, and you'll find others in other places. Don't try to memorize them, but index them and learn how to find the ones you need in a hurry. Study the techniques and principles we've talked about and practice writing legal descriptions. Practice particularly how to find samples quickly and be able to use them. Now, as the saying goes, that's all, folks. The rest is up to you. Good luck with your test.